Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Give God some praise again for our time. Bless us in a very real way. And we do praise God for that. Turn with me to 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. As our president says, 2 Chronicles. Chapter 7 and verse 14. We have to say amen.
Amen.
If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. A few minutes, I want to talk to the subject, properly positioning prayer. Positioning prayer properly. Positioning prayer. Prayer is the core of a house of prayer. That book by Cheryl Sachs, she talks about how you deal with prayer says something about your priorities or your attitude toward prayer. There are some churches where prayer is like a light, it's up from the church and kind of shines a little bit on the ministries. You have a ministry or start off with prayer, end up with prayer. But prayer is not really a part of their body. And there are some churches that have prayer as a co-ministry. They have a prayer ministry, and it coexists with the other ministries. It's a ministry, but it's not really a part of the church. You understand that you choose what ministry you work in, so that, you know, ushers feel like they don't have to have a positive attitude about the choir. People in the mission got a problem with the brotherhood. And there are certain people who involve themselves in certain ministries and can be totally frivolous of other ministries. I'm involved in this, and this is it. I wish I had a witness here. So if prayer is a ministry, it's all right for me to ignore prayer, because I don't participate in that ministry. But Jesus says, this should be a house of prayer.
All right.
In a house of prayer, then prayer is the core of the church.
Yeah.
I wish I had a witness. Prayer is in the center, and all other activities spring out from that core.
Okay.
You don't have activities unless you pray about it.
Yes. Right.
You can't minister if you don't get direction.
Yeah.
If I'm going to minister, ministry is obeying what God has told me to do. It's meeting, not just meeting the need, but it's meeting the needs that God directs. So before I attempt to minister, I need to pray. I'm in charge of the preaching ministry. I'm supposed to preach to y'all every Sunday. But you see, I shouldn't get my sermon out of a book. Y'all better hear me today.
Yeah.
And I'm not like y'all president. I do read books. But I don't get my sermon out of a book.
Yeah.
I get my sermon from the Lord.
All right.
I wish I had a witness here. I told you what Sandy Ray said years ago. And the students trying to impress him. But Dr. Ray, how do you get your sermons? And Dr. Ray says, my best sermons, I don't get them, they get me. I wish I had a witness here. All I'm trying to tell you, you can't minister for God if you don't first pray about it. Do I have a witness here? That prayer is at the core. Prayer is at the core. You pray before you meet. You pray before you come to church. You pray when you get to church. And when you get through praying, you ought to have some directives from the Lord. This very popular verse, y'all know it better not do it. I won't take long. I know y'all want to go see that bowl. But this is a verse that's very popular, but it speaks to our situation as we focus on prayer. That Solomon has just had this great ceremony for dedicating the temple of God. God has allowed him to build the temple, and he built the temple, and he celebrates the temple. He gives sacrifices, I mean, to tens of thousands of bulls and goats and sheep. I mean, homeboy spent some money on just sacrificing. You see, you can tell how people feel about God by how much they spend on God. That if you really love him, you don't cheat God. So when he did all of that, he begs God, see, this is the building we built, but it's your house. This is your building. And since it's your building, we want you to come and take possession of your building. I think I'll tell you, because some of y'all think y'all own the building. If you own the building, ain't stop to it. And see, what makes the building special is not who paid for it, not even who built it. What makes the building special is when God indwells. It ought to be the house of God. If it's the house of God, it ought to be the house of prayer. If it's the house of God, God is in charge. But Solomon understood that. And so Solomon said, there are some things that we expect you to do. He says, when we pray, we want you to hear us. When we call on you, we want you to respond. This is the place that people will come with their hurt, with their aches and their pains. This is the place that people will come when they need help. When they want to hear a word from you, they can come to your house. This is where you live. They may not be able to get your own fifth street. They may not be able to get you downtown, but they should be able to come to your house and talk to you. I wish I had somebody. And so God responds. And when God responds, he says, you know what? He says, I'm going to respond to that. He said, I like what you've done. And the Bible said, he appears to Solomon at night. The second time I thought, he Solomon had a lot of prayer in his bed while he's dreaming. Now, that's a sermon right there. You see, it's good when you're so close to the Lord, you can talk to him in your sleep. See, what's good about talking to God in your sleep? God's got to speak to you more than you speak to him. The Bible says God came to him at night, and he talks to him in a dream. And God says, I'm going to let you know something, Solomon. And he starts there at verse 12. He says, you know what? He says, I heard your cries, and there's going to be some time when I'm going to have to do some correction. There's going to be some time I'm going to have to do some chastising. There's some time when you're going to mess up, and I'm going to have to straighten you up. There's some time when you're going to do it the wrong way. I'm about to show you what the right way is. He said, don't be that. He didn't say, if you're going to do it. He said, yeah, I know you're going to mess up. He said, but when you mess up, I want you to know I'm going to fix it. He said, if I people, I wish I had a witness here, will call by my name, will humble themselves and pray. I wish I had somebody here. Let me start right there, and I'm going to talk about the stipulation that here he says there are some conditions to whether or not you get to the healing. There are some conditions, he said, and understand, he's not talking to everybody. This is not for the unsaved. This is not for the unchurched. This is not even for folk who go to church and don't know God. He says, I'm only talking to my people. Oh, y'all better hear me today. I'm talking to my people. Not only am I talking to my people, I'm talking to my people who are called by my name. Oh, yeah, you You got a lot of y'all sneaky Christians. You want to be a Christian in church, but you don't want nobody to know it on your job. You want to be a Christian in church, but you don't want nobody to know it when you're in the store. You want to be a Christian at church, but you don't want nobody to know it on Saturday night. He said, I'm talking to folk who are my people, and you're called by my name. Do I have a witness here? My people, my people, God's people. Are you God's people? Does God own you? You know, Israel was God's people. Israel was God's chosen people. And they have a special place. God chose them, the Bible says, not because they were perfect. God chose them because that's his sovereign right. I wish I had a witness here. But I came by to tell you that Israel are not the only God-chosen people. Paul had us understand that Israel were descendants of Abraham. Abraham is the father of the faithful. And the writer of the Hebrews have us to know everybody who's faithful is really a child of Abraham. Now, everybody who chooses, I wish I had a witness, to have faith in God, God chooses you. You see, we understand you're a Christian not because you chose God, but because God chose you. God chose you before you were. God chose you before you were born. God chose you before the foundation of the world. And since God chose you, you chose him. And God says, you need to understand who you are. You need to understand you are a child of the King. It all comes together. He says, whoever is born of God has the Spirit of God. Yeah. Come on here, somebody. Now, I'm a child of God, not just by a slang. I'm a child of God, not because of some label. I'm a child of God because the seed of God lives in me. The Spirit of God lives in me. The Holy Ghost indwells me. I'm a child of God because I've got some God in me.
Stipulations, specifications. That's kind of simple.
Stipulation, condition, specification, a formal condition. So why are you repeating yourself, preacher? Well, specifications are a little bit more detailed. Stipulation.
All right.
I'm going to take my word for it right here. He said, I got some specifications. If you my folk, if you my people, there's some things I expect from you.
Yeah.
If you're my people, I'm going to have mercy. I'm going to whip you. Do I have a witness here?
Yeah.
He said, but I got some specific specifications from you. God gives a detailed description of his requirements for those of us who claim to be his people.
Yeah.
He says, number one, you have to humble yourself.
Yeah.
Come on.
Oh, I wish I had a witness here. I don't have time to talk about that. I can talk from now to the Super Bowl coming. Let me just run over it right quick and understand. Humble, when he says humble, he didn't say, let me humble you.
No.
I wish I had a witness here. He said, you need to learn how to humble yourself. See, we got some folk who too high-minded and too selfish and too self-focused. They think it's all about them. And when you think it's all about you, you're going to have some attitude when it comes to God. And you got to humble yourself. Don't look for your mama to humble you. Don't look for your dad. Don't wait for the preacher to humble you. You need to humble yourself. When you get all mad because they didn't call your name, when you get mad because they didn't treat you right, when you get mad because you're not the center of attention, you don't need to talk to nobody else. You need to just humble yourself. Guess what? The world ain't about you. The world don't revolve around you. The day is not about you. It's all about God. If you want to give somebody some glory, you ought to give it to God. If you want to brag on somebody, you ought to brag on the Lord. Well, they didn't treat you right. Guess what? You're not by yourself. None of us get treated right all the time. We black folk, we know what discrimination is. You know what it means to be mistreated. And you don't even need white folk to be mistreated. You can get mistreated around a bunch of black folk. You know how we discriminate against each other. We don't like you if you're from a certain neighborhood. We don't like you if you're with somebody we don't like. We don't like you if you don't drive a car like we drive. We don't like you if you don't dress the way we dress. We don't like you if you don't look the way we look. We don't like you if you don't act the way you act. We got a whole lot of reasons to discriminate. But guess what? Get over it and humble yourself. You need to humble yourself. Stop tripping over you. Stop getting mad over you. Some of y'all can't worship God for tripping over you. You come up here with all that baggage, whole lot of mess. Just you've been carrying for 20, 30 years. It ain't about you, baby. It's all about the Lord. You need to have a spiritual man. You need some Holy Ghost soul to wash all that mess off of you. You need a spiritual transfusion. Pray. When you humble yourself, you learn how to break it all. Break all of right. You can't go to God all standing up. You can't go to God thinking you all left. When you go to God, you got to go as a youth detention before a full crowd. You don't stand up in the presence of God. You humble yourself. Do you have to kneel down? No, you don't have to kneel down every time you pray. But if you don't kneel your body, you ought to at least kneel your spirit. You have to get on your knees and hold your head. But you ought to get prostrate before the Lord. Every now and then you ought to lay on the floor when you call on Him. In other words, when I'm talking to God, I know I'm not God's equal. When I'm talking to God, I know I'm not on God's level. Some of y'all call Him the big hill, and some of y'all say the big hill, man, big hill. You don't talk to God just any kind of way. God is sovereign. God is the devil's God. God is in a class all by Himself. You don't need nobody else. When you talk to God, hold your head down. When you talk to God, you recognize who you in. Yeah, I wish I had it with you. I was in the spirit. He said, I saw Him high and lifted up. But not only did he say, humble yourself and pray, but he said, seek my face.
Yeah.
Seek my face.
Yeah.
In other words, see, you got a lot of folks praying that you're going through the most.
Yeah.
He said, I want you to pray going through the most. I want you to pray until you're in the very presence of the Lord.
Yeah.
See, there's a difference in going to church and worshiping God.
Yeah.
There's a difference in being in God's house and seeing God. There's a difference in being in God's house and being in God's presence. I wish I had a witness here. You see, when I pray hard enough so I'm in the presence of God, I can see I'm in the presence of God. When I see God, certain things don't happen in the field. I told you, I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell among the unclean people. He said, when I'm in God's presence, He changes my attitude. In the presence of God, He tells me what's wrong with me. In the presence of God, He shows how to fix what's wrong with me. I want to be in His presence. You got to see my face. Some of y'all don't remember. I told you about my Amy. Sister Virgin Home. Nobody call her Miss Virgin. We call her Amy Virgin. We call her Nanny. N-A-N, Nanny. She was our great Amy. She's my mama's mama's sister. We call her Nanny. Nanny didn't have any children. And she had more children than anybody.